Isn't this incredible?
Yes. How has your time in Africa been so far?
Incredible. Unforgettable.
What is the message you want to send to the world on behalf of your husband's administration with this trip?
That we care, and we want to show the world that we care. And I partnered and I'm working with the USAID, and I'm meeting some of them here as well. And that's all I want to show, that we care.
Do you plan to push for more funding for USAID when you get back?
Sorry?
Do you plan to ask your husband for more funding for USAID when you get back?
We are having funding, so we are helping the countries, and we're working hard for helping them, and we will continue to do so.
Mrs. Trump,
what
given your husband's comments,
what you've seen on the tour, on the trip this week?
I was so busy, I didn't have time, but I will when I come back to Washington, D.C.
Given some of his derogatory comments reported about African countries, what will you tell him in response to that? And did that come up at all on your trip? Did anybody discuss that with you?
Nobody discussed that with me, and I never heard him saying those comments, and that was an anonymous source, and I would leave it at that.
Back home, Me Too is a huge debate, and your husband says it's a tough time for men. Given that your trip here has centered on children and girls, what do you agree with him?
Well, I would say that if we're talking about the Supreme Court and Judge Kavanaugh, I think he's highly qualified for the Supreme Court. I'm glad that Dr. Ford was heard. I'm glad that Judge Kavanaugh was heard. FBI investigation was done, is completed, and Senate voted.
Did you believe Christine Ford?
I will move on that. I think all the victims, we need to help all the victims, no matter what kind of abuse they had. But I'm against any kind of abuse or violence.
Mrs. Trump, can you describe your role advising your husband? Some people interpret some of the decisions you've made, such as coming to Africa and some of your tweets, as a way of sort of not necessarily undermining, but poking at him a little bit, trying to influence him. Can you describe that?
Well, I don't always agree what he tweets, and I tell him that. I give him my honest opinion and honest advice, and sometimes he listens and sometimes he doesn't, but I have my own voice and my opinions, and it's very important for me that I express what I feel.
So sometimes you are trying to steer him maybe to be a little bit more polite in his public discourse and to maybe be a little bit more centered to some of his
policies? No, I tell him my opinions, what I believe, and maybe in some of them we don't, you know, maybe don't agree. He will do. I'm not elected, so he's the president.
Have you ever told him to put his phone down?
Yes.
Yesterday you were in Kenya.
Yesterday, there's been some discussion about your hat yesterday.
You know what?
Today
we just completed an amazing trip. We went to Ghana, we went to Malawi, we went to Kenya. Here we are in Egypt. I want to talk about my trip and not what I wear. And that's very important.
All right, so since we're just getting that sound in, we wanted to bring in Areva Martin, CNN legal analyst and civil rights attorney, as well as Laura Barone Lopez, congressional reporter for the Washington Examiner. Ladies, thank you so much. Areva, first and foremost to you, we heard the first lady there say that she believes Brett Kavanaugh is highly qualified, and she's glad that Dr. Ford was heard. What was your takeaway there?
Well, you know, I'm glad she said that she was glad that Dr. Ford was heard. What she didn't say was how the senators basically maligned Dr. Ford, how they said they believed her, but yet they believed Brett Kavanaugh more. What she didn't talk about are the thousands of survivors that descended on the Senate over this last week to encourage senators to not vote to confirm Brett Kavanaugh. What she didn't talk about was the standard that Susan Collins is using, this so-called presumption presumption of innocence that seemingly only applies to white male Republicans, because we haven't seen that whole that standard used when it comes to minority men, when it comes to underprivileged individuals, when it comes to immigrants. So I'm glad to see Melania make that statement, but I wish she would go further. I wish she would really talk about the what we're seeing happening with respect to this confirmation and how it is undermining thousands and thousands of survivors who have come forward and who are finding their voice, but who are getting a message today with this confirmation that their voice and their issues don't matter to this Republican Senate.
Laura, do you have a sense that if the First Lady talked in more detail about this, about her feelings towards it, about these kind of issues, that it would further the conversation along, that she has a prominent voice here?
I'm not sure that it would further the conversation that much. I mean, we have seen the First Lady be at odds with her husband, President Trump, on a few issues, and their little battles have, you know, leaked out into the press. But what I will say is that Trump doesn't seem to listen to the First Lady as well as his daughter Ivanka Trump as much as you know, those family members like to say that he does. Everything that we know about Trump so far in his administration, in his presidency, is that the last person in the room is who he most likely will listen to. And so given that, I think that maybe some members of the American public want to hear more from the First Lady, but I don't expect that she will be at odds that much with her husband.